We're glad to have Jin here today. Let me just read out basically his resume a little bit. He finishes, say, undergraduate study in, say, China, and then moved to France, right? No, you go to US, you go to France, you go to France, right? Okay, you don't get your Chinese degree, but then you go to France for your, say, postgraduate study, right? And then this is University of Technology of Copay, right? Did I pronounce it correctly? 1986. And then he became a senior research engineer and head of the residual stress in coating adhesion laboratory at the French Technical Center for Mechanical Industries from 1987 to 1994, right? So, and then he moved to another French university, Troyes, right? From 1994 to 2005, and then Faculty of Mechanical Engineering at the Hong Kong Polytechnic University from 2005 to 2010. And then his career progressing very fast. So he moved to CTU in 2010 and currently Chair Professor of Mechanical Engineering and Director of Center for Advanced Structural Materials. And he's also the Vice President Research and Technology and Dean of Graduate Studies. So Professor Liu is basically, say, an expert in the materials area. And then the key topic that he's going to talk about today is recent development of high strength and high ductility nanostructure materials for lightweight structures through advanced design. And Jian also is doing a lot of research work, say, with his Chinese partners, especially in the nuclear engineering, say, area. And so this is his crossing the boundaries between, say, materials and also energy. So we are welcome to have, we are very glad to have Jin here today. And so, Jin. Yeah.
So thank you, Matthew, for this introduction. So ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon. So it's my great pleasure to be here because 15 years ago, I gave first lecture in Hong Kong. That was in the mechanical engineering department. I was invited by Professor Professor Lee for the Ricky Lee. Okay, so then I know Hong Kong and now I moved to City University. So today, my topic is related to the development of the high strength, high ductility material. So probably this is not a very attractive title because we always work on the nano bio here. So basically, this is the outline of my presentation. So I will present basically the background and the introduction of the concept of this new type of nanostructured material, and then I will move to the different concept for enhancing the ductility of brittle material for increasing the strength of ductile material with different type of approach. So from microscopic to macroscopic approach and nanometric and the microscopic approach and atomic and nanometric approach. And I will show you the future development and the potential application and some conclusion at the end. So what's the motivation for my research area? So as Matthew say, I work in different areas, but one keyword can describe all my research career is plasticity of the material. So only one mode. How we apply plasticity to the material, this is one of the illustration I want to show you. So as you have an Institute of Energy and also other research for the environment. So I just want to say here, basically what's happened today with the rapid development in China. China become the first CO2 emission country with roughly 7.8 billion ton CO2 per year. And one third comes from the production of steel and concrete. Another one third from power plant, then another one third from transportation and the rest. So how we can reduce this and how we can develop different advanced material for this? So this is the background. As you may see, China represent for about 40% of consumption of production of a major metal. And with all this, and also China become number one in terms of automotive industry and also emission very soon for the total number of car they have. So this is the graph in 2011. You can see the production in China in automotive is already roughly the double of United States and Japan. So what's the trend for our pollution? So what we should do is how to reduce this pollution by enhancing the efficiency of the use of a material. So this is my major topic today. So how we can generate energy more efficiently and how we can reduce the consumption for the development of a lightweight structure. I just give you a trend for the automotive industry. Okay, for example, for a car of 2007, you have still a lot of steel. So roughly today, steel represent still a major material in the car. But so the major change for the next trend is to change from 9.5%, what we say, advanced high-strength steel to 35% advanced high-strength steel. And this move basically is to reduce the weight of the structure, because when you reduce the weight, then you can drastically reduce the emission. This is even more critical for the electrical vehicle, because electrical vehicle, the energy density of the battery is much more lower than the internal combustion machine. So if we can reduce the weight of the car without compromising the safety issue, then we can save a lot of energy even for the electrical vehicle, because it's more relevant for the electrical vehicle. So what's the target? So this is the new generation of high-strength steel for lightweight structure. This is a roadmap for Europe. So what they say, 2030, they want to reach this yellow zone. So basically, you can see for the same elongation of material, strength should be much more higher. Or for the same strength of material, the same strength elongation should be higher. And for the same elongation, strength should be much more higher. So I will show you how we can reach already this target today with the laboratory scale development. So where is the origin of our research? It's a nanocrystalline material. So the basic idea was proposed by Professor Glatter 30 years ago. So he will visit us very soon. So basically what he says is when the grain size is reduced down to the nano scale, so lower than 100 nanometer, the volume fraction of grain boundary will drastically increased, and that may totally change the physical, chemical, and mechanical property of this material. So for this reason, many people 30 years ago work on the nanostructured material by producing nanostructured powder. So what's the challenge for the this kind of material? Basically, we all know when you reduce the grain size based on the hot patch relation, then you can have high strength material. It's very good. But however, nobody told you when the strength enhanced, then the ductility basically reduced. So basically, we had the research challenge is for conflicting property between strength and ductility. So basically, this is one example of the nanostructured stainless steel. Now we can see the yield stress can be increased by 6-7 times, but elongation is drastically reduced down to 3-4%. So another key problem is for integrating nanostructured material and the bulk metallic glass for structural application. It's poor ductility and the difficulty to form the material at a large scale like a car, etc. So compared to the so-called bulk nanocrystalline material, the major problem is, first of all, to produce the nanostructured powder. Second, it's a high cost, contamination, and the porosity. So it's very difficult to produce a nanostructured material without any porosity, also without with very few, say, default inside. So what we proposed was a surface nanocrystalline material with a local treatment of engineering material, and we can generate superior surface sensitive property wear corrosion fatigue, but that also include the chemical sensitivity and physical sensitivity. I will show you at the end what we can do with some functional material of like a nanofiber, carbon nanofiber as a functional material. So basically we use different tools by using the in situ mechanical test and the combination with a simulation tool like molecular dynamics and large scale finite element, we can predict and verify the mechanical property, physical property of this kind of material. So this is basically the different tool we develop and we use for the characterization and the investigation of our material. So what's the definition of surface nanocrystallization? So the basic concept to distinguish the process I will present to you with other technology to generate the nanocrystalline material. Basically, we distinguish the material with a so-called, I call it conventional, because so the material, basically, we edit one layer of nanostructure on the top of material A with a different composition material B. So I call it conventional, the PVD, CVD, plasma spraying, all the other technology with additive nanomaterial, I call it conventional. But it's no longer conventional, but what I want to talk about is the surface mechanical attrition treatment. So in this treatment, we don't change any composition of the material. We just generate nanostructured material on the surface in situ. So this is a fully dense nanostructured material, interface free. Here you see a line, but it's not the interface. It's basically based on the definition of the 100 nanometer. We just say, okay, all the layer with a nanogram, grain size smaller than the 100 nanometer, then we can say it's a nanocrystalline material on the surface. But this is basically porosity free and interface free. We don't have interface, okay? Then this material, as I said, not only change the mechanical property, but also change the chemical property of the material. So basically, we can enhance or facilitate the diffusion treatment, diffusion property of all this surface. So with another material, you can easily form another chemical, form a surface with another chemical composition. So we call it hybrid surface nanocrystallization. So I will show you some small example here because today I will mainly focus on so-called surface self nanocrystallization. How? Yeah, please. Thickness is for the gold that can go to 300 micron. Then for the some material, it's typically from 10 to 400 micron. So it's to us for mechanical engineer, it's a surface. But for you, it's already a very bulk material. So you can produce any nanostructured material with any composition with a thickness at least 10 micron. So you can also, some colleagues, they extract this layer to do some other in situ test and in situ experimentation. Now you use FIB to remove the layer. You can build inside or do MEMS inside of this. So it's not a problem. No porosity, porosity zero. It's only defect, yeah. Because it's not a bottom up system. It's on the top of this material, we don't edit any material, okay? We just change the internally the grain size. So I will. Diffusion, because when you have the grain size, diffusion is like a tea egg. Okay, you break the shell, then the soja sauce can easily get in. So this is our paper in science. So I will talk about this. You can say it's a nano porous, but it's much more, it's regular and random. So you generate a nano crystalline grand boundary. But this grand boundary is a shortcut for chemical reaction. For this reason, we have published one paper in Science showing the diffusion is even faster than the so-called grand boundary diffusion. Okay. So what's happened in our material? So basically, this is a normal large crystalline material. So when you generate a plastic deformation, then you generate dislocation. And when you shake in another direction, then you generate other dislocation. So when this dislocation interact, so you can cut divide this large grind down to the nano. Okay, so this is the random shock of this ball on the surface of the material. So this is a typical example of the fatigue sample. Okay, so what's happened? So for those who are still know how to prepare a Chinese dumpling, so basically when you cut the meat, you need to change the direction, okay? Then when you change the direction, you have a small meat like this. But when you don't change the direction, whatever you can have a very thin layer, but it's still not two-dimensional or three-dimensional nanomaterial. In the movie, basically, it's a random motion with the acoustic wave. We generate a random motion of this ball. So it's a Brownian movement then in all the directions. So we need very low energy to cut this grain. Okay? Usually, we need to use the so-called severe plastic deformation. Now, when we invent this, then the people say, oh, this is just surface SPD. I say, no, it's exactly the inverse direction, okay? Because when you have severe plastic deformation process, the loading direction is fixed, okay? So you need to have very high load to cut the grain down to the nano because you always have some grain badly oriented. So you need a very strong overload deformation. It's an SPD, it's not severe plastic deformation, but it's small plastic deformation. It's exactly the opposite way of the normal SPD. So after I explain the whole process, they decide to allow us to have the name, not call us surface SPD, okay? So what's happened inside of this? Basically, you can generate dislocation, and then in another direction, you can cut this and progressively you can generate a random grain size, okay? So to facilitate the simulation, we had developed an algorithm which can take the TEM picture directly to represent the grain distribution, nano grain distribution in a finite element method simulation, okay? So for this reason, we can simulate large scale material. So this is a two micrometer with around 20,000 grain. So that we can predict what's happened inside of this mechanical material. So how to control the crack to not generate a strain localization problem to generate a brittle material. So the first one is toughening by delocalization of deformation at macro and micro scale using the layered structure. So basically we use this material with high yield strength, high ductility through the combination of the surface mechanical attrition and corroding technique. So basically, we form a nanostructured layer in two sides of the surface, and by corroding together, then we have a multi-layer system to get this kind of material. So compared to other accumulative rolling bonding technology, as you can see, for example, for the curve C, for the same yield stress of 900 MPa, the elongation for our case may be 3 to 5 times higher than this classic ARB when you do the corroding process. And what's happened? In fact, usually when you carry out the tensile test of this material, you generate a localization and then you have a necking. So in this particular material, we have generated a so-called multiple necking phenomena. So by generating multiple necking phenomena, then you don't have a localized situation. Then the elongation is much more higher than the base material of a layered structure. So in this particular material, we have successfully embedded three toughening mechanisms of non-localization of deformation. So basically, first of all, we introduce a very high compressive residual stress to generate the crack closure mechanism. Due to the gradient structure, okay, we have a crack blunting mechanism, and due to the layered structure, we have a crack deflection mechanism. So in one material, we can say embedded or integrate these three mechanisms. So what's happened? So this is a layered structure. For each layer, we have a gradient structure. At the surface, we have a 10 nanometer, and for the depth, we have 40 nanometer, and at center of each of these three layers, we have around 1.4 microns. So we have this gradient structure for first mechanism. Is it new? I don't invent any wheel, because in the past, many years ago, we already have this kind of process with a multiple layer system, and like a laminate Japanese sword. So it's in fact embedded already, but now we know better what's happened. What's happened? Basically, when we develop this kind of material, and we have done some simulation at the interface, by introducing different type of the adhesive element and adhesion between the layer, we can generate this multiple necking system inside of this material, so that we can generate high strength, high ductility material. So what's the results? We, as you may see, the laminate nanostructure stainless steel compared to the classic stainless steel, for the same elongation, we have double or triple strength, or for the same strength, we have double or triple elongation. But when you talk with the industry, the people say, oh, what you do is very good, but we are industry. We are not interested by this multi-layer system as automotive industry directly, because that may cost a lot. So what we have done? Okay, you are not happy, so we try to develop another strategy. So it's a toughening by delocalization of deformation, but at micro and nano scale, using the high-density twin steel. So in this particular thing, what we try is to design and realize structural material with this property through an optimization of nano-twinning structure by high-intensity SMAT using the advanced numerical simulation. So basically, we combine high-speed camera with advanced dynamic simulation of our, to predict what's the evolution of the material, what's the residual stress we can introduce, and what's the modification of the yield stress inside of this process, okay? Then we can predict the grain size after random angle impact and the normal angle impact, okay? So basically, we combine these two, and we can have a grain size obtained by this material. And basically, what we have successfully produced is a so-called high twin density material. Because when you have high twin density, then material basically is a high strength and high ductility material. So as Professor Shen, you ask, so you may see this is an 800 thick material layer, and all the 800 micron was changed. Okay, but with the higher twin density on the surface, top 100 micron, but even at the center of this 800, you still have 40% nano twin. So what's the results of this nano twin? So we can see in terms of hardness, it's high density twin generate harder material, and inside of the, if we compare with the base material, the yield stress roughly is increased by 3 times and still have a very high elongation of 30%. but how that material comes. In fact, inside of this material, we have successfully embedded three types of material. One is, as I said, nanotwin material. That's a major component of the material. And also, we have embedded nanostructured austenite and martensite in this structure. And due to the very small structure, then we have a combination of a composite structure that give us high strength, high ductility. Then we have done some simulation of the, related to the work published by a collaborator, who is Professor Luker. He published a paper in Science indicating the nanogram nanotwin, if we have a relationship, if we reduce the twin spacing, then we can find the optimum. Now here, by the simulation, what we demonstrate is this optimum twin spacing is a grain size, nano grain size depending. So we have established the relationship with, can predict what's happened for him and also predict what may happen for other material with different type of grain size. So basically we can demonstrate the grain size, when the grain size, nano grain size is smaller, then the optimum for the nano twin spacing is smaller. And what we obtain is also a high strength, high ductility material, as you may see. It's clearly out of this classic banana shape between the elongation and the yield stress. Okay. So now I want to show you some more fundamental research work on the atomic level, because we have macro, nano, and now I want to show some example of a combination of micro, nano, and atomic scale non-localization. So basically, the example will be related to the enhancement of plasticity of titanium and zirconium-based metallic glass. So basically, as some of you may know, metallic glass is obtained by a fast cooling, which generates an amorphous structure in the material like this, okay? But this material is very brittle. It's like a glass, okay? So when you have a very minor defect, then you can generate a generalized crack. So for this reason, we have proposed this composite structure. By using the SMAT, we can generate some nano crystal on the surface, which can totally change the material. As you can see here, you have nanograin, and here you still have an amorphous structure. And by doing this, we generate not only a principal shear band, but we also generate a multiple shear band mechanism. Then by this study, we can roughly enhance the elongation by 400% of the metallic glass. To better understand why this may happen, in fact, we can link this mechanical property to the atomic level structure of this material. So basically, all the metallic glass is composed by a so-called free volume and atomic cluster elastic envelope, okay? Then we have developed a nano pillar test, a dynamic nano pillar test. Using this, we can clearly distinguish the effect on the modulus for this atomic, so-called free volume zone and the other hard shell, okay? Then by this technique, we can easily describe atomic scale property, then we can better develop high strength, high ductility material. So this work has been published in this. Then based on this research, we try to find different atomic structure which can generate such property. So basically the idea is to develop a material when the major shear band come, then their crystallization to change the direction of the material. And one of the material we have described and developed is zirconium-based. And we can see here, we can two type of the cluster, cluster with quasi-crystal and cluster with specific atomic arrangement, so that to generate a different mechanical property in different area, but at atomic scale. So what's happened, and by simulation, we can see if we can perfectly mix these two phases, then with a mechanical property with 20% difference between two phases, then we can generate a so-called multiple shear band mechanism. So we are still working on this, but we have more and more this kind of a mixed structure. So without changing the basic mechanical property, we can reach this. And for the zirconium-based alloy, you can see as cast, you have this property, and using different treatment, we can drastically enhance the deformation capacity under the compression test. Okay, so the next challenge is how to enhance the tensile deformation capacity, but this part is under review. So I will report for the next 15 years because I come to give a talk every 15 years. So now I already show the different, basic science part research. So I want to show you some integration for industrial application because basically I'm a mechanical engineer. So after science, I always to transform the what we do in science to the product. So I want to quote two persons. One is George Porter, Nobel laureate in chemistry. He say, I know only two types of chemistry, the applied chemistry and the chemistry which has not yet been applied. That means all the science in long run should be, may be applied, especially for chemistry and material science, eventually for condensed matter, as we have some colleagues here. Another is Jeffrey Nicholson, who is the inventor of Post-it. What he says is research is a transformation of money into knowledge, and the innovation is transformation of knowledge back into money by creating value. Okay? So I have shown this part, and now I want to try to show this part. So what's that mean? I just want to use this one. This one is after a defect in battle, the king Beru present a gift to Alexander the Greater. Okay, as you may see, the packaging was a gold box. Okay, the contents is Indian wood steel containing within the gold box. That means with technology, because at that moment, all the people know how to make gold. Very few people know how to make steel. So the steel value is higher than the gold. Okay, so this is what I want to say is today, it's the same situation because if you can massively produce this, probably they can generate more profit than gold. But I'm also working on the gold, so next time also I will come to see. Right now I have 15 postdocs working on the gold, so I will come back again probably shortly for this. So today I want to show the example of the energy saving, energy production application. So first one is energy saving, the lightweight vehicle and EV. And the second one is energy production for wind energy structure and the new nuclear energy fuel system for life extension. So the first one is an example of a crash box. As you know, the safety of the car, especially for low speed shock, is mainly depend on this so-called energy absorber behind the bumper, okay? This is an element for which each car have at least four energy absorption, okay? So this is also a key element for EV, because in EV, you want to have a light structure, but you don't want to have problem when you hit a big internal combustion car. So how we can enhance this? And so based on this material, we can generate different, all kind of material. Because as I say, the yield stress can be changed from 1 to 5. So you have a lot of latitude to design many new crash box, new type of crash box to enhance the absorption, energy absorption property. So using the most advanced steel we have compared to, this is a Ford car, okay? It's quite an old model, but the energy absorption is can be enhanced by 400%. To today's most advanced car, the energy absorption may be enhanced by 200%. So that means we can, with the same weight, we can handle more energy or with same energy control, and we can have reduce the weight by two. And also another very critical issue is on the roof. So we can easily, with the same sheet, we can easily carrying more, three to four times more load for this car. So in two ways, we can already easily enhance the mechanical property and reduce the weight for vehicle. So, and this is a direct application, so without any design element. But if we work with this kind of new structure, say lattice structure, then we can even more enhance the combined design and the material. As you can see here, this is crushed after 120 kN. But for this particular example, up to 250 is still there. So our machine capacity is not enough high to broken this system. So combining the new design and the new material, then we can even further enhance the material. So this is another example for the bending load. So if normal bending load is like this, after some design, we can see with the corrugated panel, we can drastically enhance the load which can be carried by the structure. And if, so this is here, 4,000. And then if you add it even more, you can easily use this kind of structure in the aircraft, etc. Then you can carry, for the same weight, you can carry even more, so 10 times more. Okay, so this is the, in future what we want to develop. So combination of advanced material with the structure. Now I move to the energy production side, because before it's energy saving. As you may see here, this is a wind energy density for China, and this is a solar energy density for China. Okay? As you may see, there are two characteristics. First of all, we are in Hong Kong. You can see no solar energy, no wind energy. Okay? Even government want to change the energy mix, it will be difficult and challenging to have 10% as predicted in their policy statement. So for this reason, we have more nuclear reactors. So today, we have around 22 nuclear reactors within 6-7 years. And here, you have six nuclear reactors in operation at, I think, 25 to 30 kilometers from here. From okay, at CTO, we're more safe at 40, 45 kilometers. So what's the problem? As you may see, for China, the solar energy and wind energy are located in very in some area for which we don't have a road. Okay? So if you want to produce more energy or everything related, then the structure should be much more light. So for this reason, I work with this idea comes from a company which produces the solar energy, because the transportation cost is very high. The second example I will show you is in the nuclear power. So basically, we have developed a new design for wind energy. So basically, it's like a sheet. Then with this kind of assembly, so we can develop this kind of wind tower, new wind tower, wind energy tower module. We have calculated, basically, we can reduce by half the weight for this kind of structure. So this is one example. And it comes to the T-egg for diffusion. So this is typically like this. So when you're using our technology, you can break the shell, so the source can be easily diffused inside of the material. So each egg is a one grain. Okay, so when you shake this, then you can. This is for Western people. It's a steak tartare in French Western cooking system. So because we have Chinese audience and international audience, so I always show these two. So basically, it's easier to penetrate the thing. So basically, this is the hybrid surface nanocrystallization. So basically, using this technique, we can drastically reduce the not only the we can faster the chemical reaction, but also we can drastically reduce the temperature for the reaction. So that may be very helpful for many material. Okay, for this particular case, we talk about the next generation of fuel assembly. So today, the fuel assembly is in zirconium alloy. But for the next generation, the working temperature is higher. So very probably, we will use stainless steel. But for the stainless steel, the problem is during the flow of this inside of this structure, then we generate a so-called fretting fatigue. Then we need to use nitriding to do this to treat this sample. Okay, but stainless steel is very difficult to do the nitriding. So after the treatment, the nitriding thickness can be enhanced from 5 micron to around 300 micron. Then this is the machine we have developed for the transformation of the tube of a very long distance. Okay, so it's a random motion generated for the tube, and this is the automation of the machine. Okay. So as many people here are working on the functional material, so I just want to show you what we are able to do for the functional material. So for example, we have an original pure titanium sheet. After the treatment, then we can generate a nanotube array. And then this nanotube, the quality and the quantity are totally different. Another example is production of carbon-based nanofiber on the SMAT metallic substrate. So we have stainless steel, copper, nickel, and titanium. So basically, we can produce the nanomaterial, but the growth mechanism is totally different because usually we use nanopowder as catalyst, but here we use the whole surface. Then when the chemical reactant come, then the carbon arrive, and then at the end, what is strange is we have all these catalysts go out from the surface. Okay, so that means we don't need to do any process in future to have the link between this carbon nanofiber and the metallic material. So we have the junction directly between one metallic part and the substrate. So that may be an interesting thing. Another thing is we can drastically enhance the production of the nanostructure. So this is as received. It's a copper oxide. So we use a normal process to produce copper oxide nanowire. So it's like this. And if we treat the surface before this reaction, then you can see the density is much more higher. So this is the first thing. Because we can reduce the temperature of a reaction, so then the size may be much more smaller using under the same condition. Okay, so this is also a possible feature for the material. And the third one is when we active the surface, we can also obtain different type of crystal bone. This is by accident, but we are not able to reproduce because one student comes after another student. We know what's the material inside, but I didn't have enough time. But what I want to say is we can really change the reactivity of the surface to produce a lot of new material. But as my field is structured material, so I open the floor to develop collaboration if you want. We can active any crystalline material by generating nanostructure in all type of metallic material, gold, silver, whatever you want. Okay, so this is a different flow we can generate. Another issue is when we active the surface, we have successfully used the AFM. Okay, you just inject voltage between the tip of AFM and the substrate. So if you use the normal AFM, no reactivity. You need to have a very huge amount of very high voltage to generate oxidation on the surface. But using the active surface, then we can easily generate nanostructured dot. So this, the size of this dot, so this had been done when I was at PolyU. So you can, each of these dots is a titanium oxide. So basically, we can easily active the surface and come with the AFM to produce this kind of local dot. So this is another possibility. So I'm pretty sure with all the basic development you have, we can develop a lot of new material because our technology is not a competing technology. It's just to enhance the surface reactivity. I don't have civil engineering, how many time? 5 minutes? Okay, so for the civil engineering, so many people use the composite structure to repair this structure. So we have developed a new system by using this sheet, okay? And we have developed a so-called sectorial structure to handle this, this crack. So when you have a crack, it's quite easily delaminate if the strength is very high, okay? So using the sectorial treatment, we can first of all handle the loading to keep the link and also avoid the debending of the very strength. So here is a high deformation capacity, here is high strength. So you have dual function. As the treatment cost is totally depend on the total surface you need, okay? Using this pattern, we can have less cost for treatment but more efficient thing for the concrete structure repair. And it's the same for the other civil structure. So we can drastically enhance the structure. So this is a steel structure and with a crack here. Then if after the crack, the loading carrying will be drastically reduced. But with one sheet of 1 millimeter, we can elevate the loading carrying back. So this is a repair. This is very important to replace the composite material because Professor King is here. Because for the earthquake area, okay, if you repair with a carbon-based composite, after the second earthquake, then the elongation capacity is very small. So it's not very safe to use the composite material. Of course, it's also still cheaper than composite material. So to conclude, the SMAT is an efficient technique to generate different type of nanostructure and to enhance the diffusion property of all crystalline material. So the future trend will be the development of material and structure with atomic, nano, micro, and macro scale functional gradient for generating different toughening mechanism based on strength non-localization concept. The multi-scale experimental and simulation tools developed are the major keys for understanding, designing, and achieving the high strength and high ductility material. So the ability of this new family of material with a variable yield stress with a range from 1 to 5 will open the way to provide a new design solution with the so-called topological optimization. It's very long. So with the, I summarize the material we develop now is here and here compared to the roadmap in Europe for 2030. So we already achieved this, but This again, we are under submission with Professor Wang Ying, and this paper was rejected two times by Nature Material and accepted for review and reject. So we are very close to the target. And to summarize what we have done from basic research to the application. So basically, we start with the concept. We have some invention on this and to develop two types of material. And for the material analysis, we have developed a dynamic micropillar test. And for the structure and the functional, we have demonstrated the fatigue wear and also biocompatibility is better. But today, I don't have time to demonstrate all this. And we already reached some application for energy, MEMS, aerospace, and biomedical and automotive. And as I expected, some student here, but it's no problem. quite often I have students in this kind of lecture. So to me, two major ways to succeed. First, of course, think outside of the box, because each time when my student present me the results, he say, okay, this one are good. These results are good. I say, what do you mean good? Because he say, oh, these are normal. Then I say, okay, I don't want to see the normal results. Everything abnormal, you should not eliminate, because the major problems, today, quite often, they see, oh, some results are not good, then they don't show to the supervisor. I ask my student always show all the results expected, especially those who are not normal. Otherwise, we cannot detect a good thing. And also, don't worry about the expert criticize, because when we start this, actually, I have three co-supervised students with Professor Luca, and at 1 year, so 2 years after, we don't have anything, but very few things. Then people criticize. So, okay, this is nobody do this, and why you do this? And, these three students was close to quit. They want to stop, change the research orientation. Then we force them to go in, and 6 months after, we have the paper for science. Okay, but when you are close to the objective, when some so-called expert criticize you, don't be shy, because all this old professor may not be right for the right orientation. You are a small cat, but no problem. Another thing is quite often we say, okay, your study, nothing new. Why it's different? It's just a heater, okay? In fact, if you say, study one, sea level, altitude, open air heating, the water at 98 degrees and 100 degrees. Say, okay, it's very similar. But I want to point out is this major difference and breakthrough. Where is the breakthrough? Because with the first study, you just generate a heater. The second one, you generate a vapor. When you have vapor, that the vapor machine comes from. Okay, so to me, it's a revolution between these 2 degree difference, and very few people may make the difference. Because the process I present to you, all people, is very simple. What's the difference between your treatment with short pinning? I say the difference is major. Short pinning is to introduce compressive residual stress. SMAT is to generate nanostructure. Okay, when you generate nanostructure, the property is different, the mechanism is different, then we can generate a breakthrough. For those who do experimentation, some people always say, oh, I always want to do acceleration test. So normally, the objective is to do the incubating, okay? So if you want to do accelerated test with higher temperature, you end up with different results. But these are two good things. You generate two things, but probably you have innovation inside of this. And for those who are doing simulation, we always have extrapolation syndrome. So all the people doing simulation always say, oh, my model can treat everything. Like never, not very few people consider the boundary condition for this. And I work with one colleague. He said, he's a model developer. He said, oh, give me 4 parameters, I will draw an elephant. Okay? Give me 5th, I will have a dancing elephant. But to me, I always told to the student, if you need 5, 6, n parameter to describe something, that means something is wrong. Nature is always simple. If you have 2 parameters, probably you are close to the truth. So for this reason, I always try to see how to reduce this parameter to describe the different thing. So when an experimentalist find the new results, all the people believe him, accepted himself. So this is because we know all the complication, all the boundary limit condition may be totally different. And when the theorists develop a new results, nobody believe him, accepted himself. So how to solve the problem is, this is what I always done, is try to break through the wall between material scientist, physics, mechanical engineer, and experimentalist, and theorist. So this is what I try to do during my 30 years career here. And I would like to thank all the funding agency, especially Chinese NSF, because they are the first funding agency which funded me and Professor Luker in 1998 to start this study. But as you may see, I had chance to be able to work in the same area during last 16 years, because when Professor Luker come to see me, he works on the amorphous material, and he wanted me to study the residual stress in the amorphous material. Then I work on the surface engineering. After our meeting in 1998, after this study, it's a big grant at that moment. It's 500,000 RMB in 1998. It's roughly 6 times of a basic grant. Okay, then he stopped to work on amorphous material. I stopped to work on surface engineering. So to work together for this new adventure. And also I would like, of course, to thank RGC for the CRF and also some Global 500 which follow me for this adventure. And I have another one I cannot announce here, but so this is all the team, Professor Luker's team and my team during this last 50 years. We work on this, and I think if we persist in the research orientation, and we can succeed with only one keyword. As I said at the beginning, plasticity is what I have done during all my career. So thank you very much. Okay, so all the results I have shown you is bulk property. It's not an extraction of this nanopart. So for example, basically the typical sample size we use here is 1 to 4 millimeters thick. So what I have shown is not the property of the top 10 micron. It's the total thickness. So for this reason, of course, if I extract only the top surface, we can see at the beginning, my first slide, basically the yield stress can be increased by 4 or 5 times, okay? So all the thing we have done is how to combine this extreme high mechanical property to get high strength and high ductility material. Because at beginning, the material is very brittle if you have only the nanostructured layer. Okay, so the results I have shown here is the, I can say, bulk property of the material. It's not only the, this example is only the surface, okay? if you extract the surface, it's like a nano powder material. So basically, the yield stress can be, say, increased by 7 times. So the material I have shown, basically, the yield stress is 1,000, and you have an elongation much more higher than this. Okay, and today, the highest is what I have shown, but I cannot show the results yet because it's not yet published, but we can have a 2 gigapascal yield stress with an elongation of 18%. So in terms of so-called specific strengths, we are higher than the so-called light metal, like aluminum, magnesium, and titanium. So if you take, say, 15% elongation as a reference, the specific strength of this material is the highest worldwide. The fracture toughness is also quite good, but I don't have fatigue property is also quite good. Because basically, fracture toughness basically is depend to on the closure mechanism. Okay, when you generate a crack, how they propagate. This, we have a good toughness because, first of all, we have a we don't have a homogeneous material. So the toughness is like ceramic. When the toughness is very small because you don't have any mechanism to stop the micro crack. And here, as I have shown, you have a lot of mechanism which can stop the micro crack so that to generate, we can generate multiple crack, multiple shear band, multiple necking mechanism. For this reason, the toughness is higher.
You develop quite a number of testing structures. Extensive application. We know that the laminate structure.
Yes. Yes. Yes.
Find any?
Right now, no. But as you may see in the sponsor, there are Airbus, EADS, and GE. So we are still working on that because the problem is to combine the reliability with this kind of structure. To convince the designer to edit a new solution is quite difficult. So for this reason, first target I have is an electrical vehicle. So next, in 10 days, I will present a talk in Detroit in the World Congress for Automotive. It's a special seminar so-called Talk to an Expert. So I will show something for automotive, and I hope they will receive the good message for that.
One of the most interesting properties of laminate body, much enhanced fatigue strength.
Yes.
Perhaps that may be also a selling point for metallic laminate.
Yes. Yes. Yeah.
Have you been able to really touch that?
Fatigue property for laminate structure, we have not done. We only done the, single sheet or single sample of material for this. Of course, as you know, although I have a big team, I cannot cover all this. If I have, say, 10% of team working on graphene worldwide, working on this topic, I think we can have more breakthrough. But for the moment, basically, the team is quite small. I think worldwide probably we have 30 group working on this type of topic. So it's not a very high fashion, but I think it's your suggestion is very good. If some colleagues are interested by the fatigue, we are doing some fatigue with some aerospace industry because due to the high compressive resistance we introduce, Because basically, when you have a base material, the compressively reduced stress you can introduce is quite small. When you transform the surface on nano, so the yield, local yield stress on the surface is much more higher. Okay? So the residual stress we can introduce is much more higher. So for the fatigue test, especially for the tension-tension fatigue test, the property is much more better, especially for low cycle fatigue. So typically, a short pinion, when you have low cycle fatigue, all the residual stress relax. It's not the case for the nanomaterial. The relaxation of residual stress is much more smaller compared to the normal short pinion.
Two simple questions. One is that from the video that you show us, right?
Yes.
My understanding is that the surface treatment, which is based on the four objects to hit the surface.
Yes.
Then you change the crystal structures.
Yes.
Increase the boundary, boundary numbers.
Right? Yes.
Traditional, as I said, the short pinion is also doing the same thing. What is the fundamental difference between the traditional
Second question.
The second question is that for this kind of nanostructure that you generated, in particular after rolling all this process, would this microstructure change? Or how actually, because it's not an equilibrium structure, isn't it? So during the application, do you expect the microstructure, or the nanostructure, will change that your property will then?
Okay, first of all, this nanostructure is quite stable because it's due to the repeat low deformation plastic deformation. Okay, so it's quite stable because we hit the material with the best favorable direction. So the energy necessary is quite small. Okay, so this is the first difference with the short pinion. Okay, so in fact, if you do a random direction short pinion, you can also generate this kind of effect. So the problem is for short pinion, first of all, it's directional. So you have a nose, then you do the short pinion. Okay? You can reduce the grain size only in some direction, not in all the direction. Second, you lost a lot of energy because you need to put the movement of the bowl to some speed. One shock, it's finished. And here, the bowl keep moving. So all the energy are used to transform the plasticity. So the quantity of the bowl is much more smaller compared to short pinning.
So the principle of, the working principle are same, right? Just break down the big grain into smaller one.
Yes, because as I said, all the people, for this reason, added this similar study, okay? Because short pinion was an event from sound blast, okay? We have a casting sample, we use sound blast, then we see, at the beginning, it's to clean the surface. Then after, we say, oh, fatigue is better. Then we say, oh, why fatigue is better? Then, in fact, we introduce compressive residual stress. So short pinion is a process to introduce compressive residual stress, okay? And this is to change the grain size, okay? To me, it's different. And also, for this reason, we got patent. Otherwise, if the same. So another element is, okay, is we should, because we need to do very close to the cracking condition, because we need to do high class deformation without crack the material. Because short pinion, if you do in the same direction very few times, then that crack, because it's like severe plastic deformation. So here, the media we use is, we should call perfect spherical. Perfect spherical is possible if the quantity of bowl is used is smaller. And for short pinion, you need to use several hundred kilograms. Okay, then industrial wide is not possible. Because I also have a patent, it's a so-called random short pinion. But this cannot never be applied. But I have the patent. Yeah.
Crystalline layer, this evolving fraction is a relatively small, thin layer.
No. It's not. No, even with the specimen, you can see here the specimen thickness is 800. Okay, so you can see this is without any treatment. Okay, under the optimized condition, you can see we transform the whole layer.
So this is the bulk nanocrystalline. Surface coating.
It's not surface coating.
It's not distinct surface treatment. Quite deep
volume
fraction of the surface.
But it's a steel surface. If you have a 10 millimeter thick component,
right,
then it's a surface.
Right. But this material, the majority of part is still ductile, lower strength. But only the surface layer is a higher strength.
Is that homogeneous?
It's not homogeneous.
Surface layer is a high strength.
Yes.
Brittle. Relatively less ductile.
Yes.
How you make eventually the bulk material symmetry still ductile?
Yeah.
That is my question.
Yeah, my question
is. The inner core is still ductile.
Yeah. What I want.
The surface layer is less ductile.
No, it's not true. No longer true for the high twin density material.
Right.
High twin density material is high strength, high ductility. Not the ductility is quite close between this area and this area. Because the twin density allow high twin density material allow more deformation capacity. Okay, so the objective today is how to even further enhance the twin density. So this is what we are doing. So we need to change the material to composition to be able to generate more nano twin. When you have more nano twin, so the work we have done with Professor Wang Ning is that we have even more nanotwin than this, then during the tensile, you still can generate other twin. Then
another question is the BMG, bulk BMG.
Yes.
High strength, quite brittle.
Yes.
Then you create a crystalline layer at the surface.
Yes.
But this is the only relatively thin layer, the surface ductile layer.
Yes.
So the bulk material is still brittle.
Yes.
The majority is still brittle.
Yes.
But how where you mentioned they achieve very high ductility.
High deformation capacity is not high ductility. Why? Because
is this under unaxial tension?
No, it's a compression test.
Compression. But tension?
Tension, I already say, if you come back to the record, I say we are still working on that. But the tensile capacity.
The core is EMG is still brittle.
Yeah, but it's not because
the surface layer is ductile.
Yeah. We have one case, the tensile deformation capacity is increased from, say, close to zero to 3.5%. Okay, but it's not reported here, and we are still submitting paper. I hope that will be published very soon. But here is a compression test. Yeah.
So how about without this crystalline layer? What is the maximum strain for
compression? No, but here, it's a
BMG.
It's a 3%. Compression for this particular alloy,
3%.
No, we can see, I think, better here. This zirconium is a very, say, famous composition for all the people. So the compression test deformation is like here, and then we can increase up to 4 times more, 16%. For this kind of material, exactly, we cannot generate nanotwin. So it's quite difficult to have a high strength, high ductility material for the aluminum alloy. Okay? No. What I say is the steel we produce is it's a lightweight material. Okay, so the steel we produce in terms of specific strength or elongation of 15%, for example, the highest strongest material we have in terms of specific strength, so strength divided by the density is lower than the strongest is higher than the strongest aluminum with 15% elongation. You see what I mean? The steel, the lightweight structure, the characteristic is a so-called specific strength. So for the unit weight, what's the strength you have? But with this concept, for elongation of 15%, why 15%? 15% basically is the material we can use for all kind of metallic structure, okay, for aircraft as well. For 15%, the strength we develop is higher than aluminum structure and magnesium and titanium structure. This is also in the work with Professor Wang Ning, but it's not yet published. So it's a steel, light than strongest aluminum. This is what I want to say. But inside of the aluminum, we work on another orientation. So we have a paper published using the metallic glass, aluminum-based metallic glass, combined with carbon fiber. Then it's like, I don't know if you know Airbus, we have a structure called glare. Okay, so Professor Wang Ning will be in the PhD defense. So basically you have one layer aluminum, and one layer metallic, one layer composite fiber, okay? For this kind of structure, if we use aluminum metallic glass as a metallic part, then we have shown the specific strength is also very high, higher than the glare used by the Airbus. So that was published already. But today, I don't have time to talk about this. Yes. Yes. Now, okay. So the intrinsic property of metallic glass, basically the theoretical strength is very, very high. Today, due to the dislocation or other thing, the real strength is, say, 1 to 2% of the theoretical strength, okay? So there are still a lot of room to, so to me, is a structure more important than the so-called absolute strength of the material, because nobody reach that high strength. It's too high. So today is how to manage the defect to have high strength, high ductility. That defect, crystalline defect, like a dislocation, like a twin, etc., etc. Possible to modify? Yes. Yes. When I talk about the hybrid, is exactly this. You can do, so we have done for the diffusion of chromium in the metallic material. You can do the diffusion of nitrogen. So that process facilitates all kind of diffusion treatment. So if you already develop something like this, after the treatment, the efficiency will become much more higher.
Okay, good. Thank you. So intentionally, I left some the presentation about Professor Ludian at the end. He received the French Light Order of National Merit in 2006. He's a fellow of the French of the National Academy of Technologies of France. So I reserved these 2 points because he's been bringing a lot of examples of food cooking.
Thank you.
And also, he's asking us to think out of the box. And so we'd like to thank, say, Professor Lu Jun again. He's putting us into, say, asking us to have a lot of food for thought.
Thank you very much.